Thank you for having the opportunity to speak at this Reddit. So we're going to talk today about open source PAC systems. And let me first show you a little bit the agenda. So we're going to talk about PAC's features and architecture. And the reason we want to talk about the features and architecture, because when people talk about the PACs, they often have a different understanding and interpretation of what a PAC is all about. And as we will see later, as a matter of fact, you can have different kinds of PACs, different types of PACs, different configurations, specifically for the kind of countries that we are talking about today. So after we talk about the features and architecture, then we'll talk about the environment. PACs is not on an island. We need to have orders, we need to have results. So we need to have an infrastructure. So we need to have an environment that is essential for the PACs to work. Then we're gonna talk a little bit about some of the implementation strategies that seem to be working, specifically again in the lower and middle income countries. I'll give you an example of a PAC system that is open source and that I was involved with myself. So you can see an example of how it could be working. And then some lessons learned and then a conclusion. So let's get started. And so first of all, what is a PAC system? So a PAC system is a picture archiving and communication system, mostly used for radiology and cardiology. But you have to realize that as of now, images are everywhere. People in dermatology, radiation therapy, of course, as well, but also endoscopy, laparoscopy, wound care, everybody's making pictures. So when we talk about a PAC system, it is not only focused on radiology or cardiology anymore, but many other specialties. Although what we find again in the lower middle income countries is that we follow the same pattern as we did in the developed world, where we typically start at radiology. So picture archiving communication system. So we deal with images, we provide an image management infrastructure. That means we have images that need to be archived and we need to manage the images. So we need to be able to have a database to index them and to be able to get them back. And then workflow infrastructure, one of the components that is often overlooked. Different workflows, one for the technologist, for the radiographer that takes the exam. There's a workflow that's provided by the PACs for those professionals, but also for the radiologist and of course for the physicians as well. So we have a workflow infrastructure as well. And so we manage the medical images and then also related information. When I talk about related information, there are different files that we need to manage. For example, today the hot topic is artificial intelligence. How do we encode the AI findings? For example, how do we do that as a markers on the images? Do we do that as a what we call presentation state, annotations? So there's a lot of related information. And of course, we have the diagnostic reports as well, but also dose reports. There's a lot of related information that we need to manage as well. So PAC system, image management workflow, images related information. So why open source? So it's because, first of all, it's free. It's free. Well, kind of, because nothing is completely free in this world. So you always need to make sure that you have a support infrastructure, but the initial purchase cost is free. And so one of the major challenges, of course, is cost. And that's why I sometimes get called into as a consultant on PAC systems. For example, one case where I must ask my advice, and there was a hospital in Tanzania that said, "Herman, we have a proposal for $350,000 to put a PAC system in. What do you think about that?" And so, for $350,000. You can do a lot of things in the valley or a couple of x-ray rooms. So cost is a major issue. And, you know, instead of $350,000, maybe you can just spend $50,000 on servers and put some company software, and that's what we did. So now another thing that you have to realize is that when you have a PAC system, there's often a commercial version as well. It's almost like a teaser what people do. So we have a commercial version of the same software that you can create. And so when you install a PAC system, you say, well, I really want to get some support, you can actually typically upgrade to have a commercial version. Another reason why we want to use open source an open source PAC system would be, I call it testing the waters. Yeah. In many cases, the professionals using PAC for the first time, they really don't know what they want and what they need. So if you don't know what the PAC system is all about, if you don't know what the features you need in your particular environment, what are your requirements, you might want to put an open source PAC in before you try to really spend the money. Another reason for an open source PAC, and that's why I personally use the open source PACs always on a routine basis, is testing, validation, and training. When I do my training, we have a bootcamp that is organized, for example, by Red 8, where we go around the world and train professionals. And then we use an open source PAC, an open source viewer. Then we can train our PAC administrators and IT people. But in addition, it's good to have a backup, right, for testing in addition to your production PAC system. Okay, so that's all by open source PACs. Now, another reason is, well, most commercial PAC systems are not suitable. They're a major overkill. They're way too expensive. They take what's used in the developing world, and you see that in other products as well. For example, here's the picture on the left. This is a workstation. Each monitor is 5 megapixel, and if you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times 5 megapixel, that was a picture I took at one of the shows. I think it was the RSNA in Chicago. This would be completely unaffordable. So what you want is what we put in Tanzania. A simple medical grade monitor, single display, right, which is a fraction of the cost, right? Another challenge is with commercial PAC systems, they're very poorly supported, and that's nothing specifically for PACs, that is typically for every medical device, both by the local and the corporate, because if you're in some kind of country, the corporate offices might be in another continent. People will not be able to just fly over to see this problem. So what we want effective solutions that are proven and that work. Here's another good example in the middle. This is a radiology system that is developed by the World Health Organization. With fixed geometry, and this unit, including completely digital, can be gotten for $40,000 to $50,000 versus the more expensive rooms. So this is the kind of solution that we're looking for in this kind of environment. So let me first talk a little bit about a typical PAX architecture to get an idea of what are the features in the PAX. So I'm going to go for the workflow a little bit. And so here's a phone and smart device, and it might have a health app. And this is actually a picture of an iPhone, and the health app on the iPhone. Now, increasingly, people are getting phones. Maybe some of them are more sophisticated than other ones, but they start collecting data. And so what we're looking for is uploading the data. And because this is all about e-health, we want to upload our data in our electronic health record, assuming you have an electronic health record or EMR. So it starts here on the top in the electronic health record, EMR, or, and you see there's a lot of acronyms that we'll be using, CPOE, Centralized Physician Ordering Entry System, or a Radiology Information System. Now, each one of these systems have the capability to place a order for a procedure. So what happens with the order, and we see in the left corner, we see a kind of an indication of the different kind of arrows that we have, the different kind of colors. So the order is being placed in a ordering system, whether it's a EMR, CPOE, or RIS, and then the order is being transferred, sent, using this white arrow, which is an HL7. This is the standard for exchanging exchanging patient-related information in the hospitals to a typical interface engine. So what is an interface engine? It's a kind of a traffic cop. It's a little piece of software. By the way, I'll talk about it later, but there's also an open source version of that. As well, there's an open source version of the EMR, right? So we can use an open source interface engine that sends then the order to the worklist provider. So what is the worklist provider? And the worklist provider is like a electronic departmental secretary. So what does the worklist provider do? It stores the order, right? Because at a certain point in time, let's say my ultrasound or my CT or my computerized radiography system, the technologist wants to query the worklist provider and gets a list of all the patients that are to be done on the ultrasound, for example. See what happens here? It's we have a yellow arrow. So here we go from HL7 to DICOM. We do a DICOM query, we get a worklist. The patient is selected, the patient demographics is copied, images are being sent to the PACS. So it's a good idea when I talk later about the environment to know what is in the environment that is needed to get this PACS system working. PACS system, so what does a PACS consist of? An indexing system. What is an indexing system? It's nothing else than a database. Image comes to the PACS. There's metadata that goes with the image. Metadata is data about data. So patient name, ID, birthday, sex. They're all stored in the database. So every PACS system has a database. It's like, think about an indexing system for a library, where you have a little card. You need to, so if you want to find a book, you know exactly what shelf to find it. Database does the same thing. Somebody wants to query for a patient, Mr. Smith, and I want to find out what are the exams. The database will tell you how to find them. Where are the images? On the archive. So there's a database and archive. So we have indexing, we have storage. Of course, we have the display system, right? One or more displays for the radiologists. So we have display, and then most important, we have a workflow manager. And what does the workflow manager do? Well, imagine that radiologist one, right, on workstation number one, pulls up a chest radiograph and starts reporting it. And then his or her colleague on workstation number two has to also look at chest images. That second radiologist needs to know that first image is being read by the colleague. So we want to make sure we have a workflow manager that provides the appropriate worklist for all of these radiologists. Or in let's say we have a little bit bigger organization, and we might have a dedicated MRI technologist, radiologist, or we have one for body, or a neuroradiologist that specializes in head and spine. All of this is managed by the workflow manager. Then, of course, we do reporting. We either type a report or we do voice recognition. And so there's a interface between the PACS and a reporting system. And that is then sent back to the interface engine and can be sent back to the EMR. So that's the PACS system and the environment. So PACS, indexing, storage, display, and workflow. Now, what are the core features of a PACS? When I talk about a bare bones PACS, a bare bones, what is that you really need to have? Well, it's the same picture as I just showed, but guess what? I took out the workflow manager. So many cases, and some of the open source PACS systems, actually most of the open source PACS systems, do not have the workflow manager. So what is the impact? The impact is that the radiologist can look in the PACS archive, request the database, and get maybe all of these CTs. And they just need to keep track themselves what is being read and what is being unread, right? Or they need to divide the work internally, so make sure there's no double reads. Okay? So one of the characteristics of most commercial PACS systems is there's a very sophisticated workflow manager that I call it the bare bones PACS, you don't necessarily always have. Right? So then we come back to a PACS core that has indexing system, a storage, and display. Now, what are some, so this is a bare bones packs. Now, let's take complete packs, or complete packs, super packs. I don't know how to call it, but a fully featured packs maybe is the best word. A fully featured packs. So let's go back. So bare bones, indexing, storage display, fully featured packs. Adds the workflow manager that we have in most commercial pack systems, but also adds the worklist provider for the technologist. What does the worklist provider do for the technologist? It takes in the orders and maps it so that when the ultrasound queries, right? Basically, there's a button that the technologist pushes, says, get my worklist. And so the worklist provider organizes it based on modality like ultrasound, CT, so that, you know, the ultrasound orders don't show up on the CT. There could even be an inpatient and outpatient CT or one for radiation therapy. All of that is organized by the worklist provider for the technologist. So fully featured packs has the worklist for the technologist as well, in addition to the worklist, to the workflow manager for the radiologist and reporting system. And that's really where a significant gain can be achieved. If a reporting system where we can do the either voice recognition or the typing, that is then integrated with a PAC system. Basically, when the radiologist says next and he selects the next patient on a second monitor, automatically the screen will show up for the radiologist to do the reporting, and the report will be created, immediately signed off, and immediately available for the physicians for, let's say, an EMR. So bare bones packs, fully featured packs. Now, one mention is about some of the standards. The standards that we use, so all these systems, the CT, MRI, PAC system, robotics, they need to connect to each other. So they need to be interfaced. We use DICOM for the imaging communication for the PACS component. See all of the yellow arrows, right? All of the yellow arrows. And by the way, I forgot to mention also a fully featured PACS also has a DICOM image back so that my physicians on the floors and everywhere where they are working, all the specialists can access the images as well. So the images and related information are communicated using DICOM. Everything that is related to orders, reports, billing, and so on, patient registration, updates are all communicated via HL7 version 2. And you probably also heard about FHIR. FHIR is the new interface and the new connectivity that is using web services. And that's typically used for external communication with mobile devices. Right? Although there are some FHIR implementations that are already getting inside the PAC systems, particularly when we talk about how to exchange all the images with all the different physicians. Anyway, so that's FHIR. So these are the standards, DICOM, HL7, FHIR. So when we talk about a PAC system, we need to make sure, and they do, they all communicate using DICOM. And when we want to get the ordering information result, we need to make sure that they all talk HL7 version 2. And so there are always specifications available that tell you exactly how that's being happening. Now, what is the essential PACS environment? When we talk about a PACS system, and so we implement this PACS system in our hospital, what is it else that you really should be looking for? Well, first of all, this worklist provider. Okay? And second, an order entry system. They go together. So somewhere you need to place an order. Now, let's say you have an electronic health record, an electronic medical record, EMR. Almost always there is a ordering screen and you can order, I don't know, lab tests, physical therapy, but then also imaging. So we can order that imaging procedure. So we need to have a ordering system and then a worklist provider. And then also a reporting system. So these are, I call, essential components for the PACS environment: order entry, worklist provider, and reporting system. So let's talk about some of the open source PACS systems. And there's several of those. So so I got a table. See, that's why I say on the table the others, there's several open source. This is the ones, these are the ones that I have the most experience with, and they're probably the most popular. Let's take, for example, Clear Cancer Viewer. I was teaching in Tanzania. We did a PACS bootcamp there for the PACS administrators. There were 15 people from the major hospitals, and I said, what kind of PACS do you use? 14 of the 15 says we use Clear Canvas. So the whole country runs on Clear Canvas. So Clear Canvas, obviously, from my experience, probably one of the most used. When I talk with the developers, they're out in Toronto, Canada, they had 50,000 downloads so far. So the viewer is an open source viewer, right? And it's very easy to install. You can download it, you can install it very easily. Then we have a server that goes with it, right? So we have PACS Clear Canvas server, also relatively easy to install. It's Windows based. Anybody with a little bit of IT computer skills can do this relatively simple. And basically, that's actually what I'll show later as an example as well. DCM4CHCE. DCM4CHCE, very important open source PACS system. I can do the, this is an archive database, of course. You can get it with some kind of a web viewer. It has a modality worklist. See, that's a major advantage. Remember the modality worklist? Let's go back to my picture. Well, I'll show you later, but the modality worklist for the modalities has it included. It's pretty good scalable, more scalable definitely than the Clear Canvas. Ease of installation, it's somewhat tricky. It's Linux based. This is Linux, Unix, this is Windows. So it's a little bit trickier. There is a, now we have these Dockers instead of the virtual machine, so you can relatively easy install it, but you need some to have some more advanced IT skills to install it and support it. OrTank, somewhat popular as well. I don't have a lot of experience, but that's another good open source PACS with a viewer. And then Conquest. Conquest is an open source PACS system used mostly for research. It was actually developed by the National Cancer Institute in Holland, in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. I use it always for my training. It's very easy to deploy. Basically, a matter of literally 2 minutes, you can install the Conquest. Now, some another viewers, Osirix, excellent viewer. The only disadvantage is it's Mac-based, and there's not a lot of Mac available. If you have a Macintosh, definitely preferable. And then OVM is a web-based viewer, and typically they use it in combination with either OrTank or DCM4CHE. So this is so many examples of the open source PACS systems. There are quite a few. I would recommend, if I would install it myself, I would, for smaller clinics, I go to Clear Canvas routes. For what bigger installation, I go to DCM4CHE route with probably OVM as a viewer. So these are the commercial, these are the products that are available and you can use. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the how to deploy these systems. And what I see, what we do typically in the developing world is typically we do a top-down implementation. What it means, okay, we get the modalities, of course. You know, we have the ultrasound, CT, MRIs, and so on. And then we get an electronic health record system, an EMR, and then we get a worklist, right? So we have the orders coming in, and then we install a PACS, and then we do the reporting. So this is a top-down approach. Top-down, we start on the top. we start in the hospital, deploying the EMR first. Right? What I see though in the LAM, the LAMC countries though is a lot of times bottom-up. And so typically, so they used to be running on film, and they said, okay, this is too expensive, it's ridiculous, all this film, this waste, this chemicals, let's get a CR system. And by the way, they also have a CT already that they print film, let's get them all electronically stored and archived. So we have acquisition modalities that are being converted into digital. And then they said, okay, oh, what do we do need to do with the images? Oh, we need a PAC system, right? So after they get some new modalities, they deploy a PAC system. Well, what is the problem? No work list, yeah? So because they didn't think about getting a work list provider, and they might not even have an EMR, right? So most of the time, we see the bottom-up strategy for the LAMC countries. And so what are some of the challenges and problems with that? So top-down is the most preferred strategy. But if you do bottom-up, which is sometimes you don't have another option, you don't have persistent, consistent patient demographics. Because what happens, let's say a patient needs to have an ultrasound and a CT scan. Somebody enters the patient demographics, patient name, ID, birth, sex, all of the information locally at that keyboard. And then the patient goes to the CT, I mean, the technology again enters that locally at that keyboard. And if you do statistics, 40% of the time there will be spelling errors, will be mismatches, right? Maybe the patient was there 6 months ago, maybe you got married in the meantime, there was a name change, or it was again misspelled. So managing these patients consistently is a nightmare. Yeah. So when you do the bottom up, you don't have a work list, a lot of manual input errors. It's also hard to relate then the orders and the reports with the images together. So if you have a completely electronic system here, what's happening? You place an order. The order is identified with an accession number. We create the images identified with an accession number. You create a report identified with an accession number. And nice thing is that everybody can keep track of that using that particular link, accession number. We don't have it. Because there's no orders. There is an order, a piece of paper. And there's a report, it's a piece of paper. Right? So it's definitely much less efficient from the technology perspective. So what we want to do is try to avoid as much as possible the bottom up. And as soon as we get a PAC in and get our EMR, and if you don't have the EMR, get an order entry system or get a bare bones radiology information system. Now, I want to show you a little bit of an example of an open source PAC system that I've been involved in by myself. And so it's a typical installation, smaller. But it worked really, really well, very successful. So that was for Zinga Children's Hospital. It's in Tanzania. It's a little bit north of there. If there would be no traffic, it would be less than an hour. But of course, being Tanzania, it would take you at least 3 or 4 hours to get there. But anyway, Zinga's Hospital, in this case, it was supported by a Rotary International grant, about $100,000. And what can we do with $100,000? We bought an ultrasound, about $10,000 ultrasound. We got some dental sensors, so that we use for dentistry as well, if somebody comes there. And then we have an X-ray, a bare bones X-ray system with a computerized radiography system plate. The hardware for the server, right? I think we put 5 terabytes in there. So a small server, a small tower. We did, of course, we did a medical background. I'll talk about it a little bit later, but one of my main concerns is always that people look at images for computerized and digital radiography on non-medical grade monitors. Absolutely, completely wrong. You need to have a medical grade monitor to look at these digital X-rays. Otherwise, you miss information. And so we can use a 2 megapixel. We don't need a 5 megapixel high resolution, because what you can always use zoom. Big price difference. And instead of 3 or 4 or 5 screens, we can do with one screen. Again, we want to make sure we keep within our budget. And then a couple of remote viewers. So we have an open source ClickCanvas server and viewer. And then one of the challenges for the viewer, the ClickCanvas viewer, one of the problems was did not have the capability for importing and exporting CDs. So we bought one commercial version, $1,500, I think. So usually you can buy a commercial version of these open source products as well for a few thousand dollars. And again, all supported by the Rotary International. The way that works is that several clubs in the United States raise the money. We find a partner club that oversees the project and is the sort of hands and eyes and ears on the ground in Tanzania. So how does it? How did it look like, this particular Zinga installation? So there was a main hospital at Children's Hospital. And the main hospital has a kind of a campus, so has several little buildings. And one of the buildings was the imaging building. So in the imaging building, patients arrive and they either walk, of course, or they most of the time they come on a little motorcycle. they arrive, they take an x-ray. And we had a Fuji x-ray system and a Fuji CR digital plate system, again, in that remote building. Also put the ultrasound, here's the radiographer, and here's the ultrasound, and in the same building will be an ultrasound. And in that building, there will be a physician, and we have a medical grade monitor. It's a 2 megapixel, we put it in a landscape mode, and put a little computer for clear canvas software. Images are then sent to the main hospital, right? It was actually only, I don't know, maybe 50 feet or so from the main hospital. It was a relatively small campus. At the main hospital, we have a portable x-ray unit, see, for dental. See, it looks like a little gun here, handheld. And we got a couple of sensors that you can connect to a USB to the computer where we capture the images. And then here you see the whole team, including myself. And then here's the tower where we have the image storage, a little management console where the server, the Clear Canvas server, is being installed. All very successful. I've been back two or three times. People are really happy. Works great. Typically for a smaller clinic, they do a couple of exams a day, and it will be a really while before they ever fill up that server. Excuse me. So this is a good example of an OpenPACS installation. So I'd like to share you some of the lessons learned, not only that I learned from this installation, but from my work and another installation that I've been involved in. Okay, so here's the lessons learned for particularly for LIMC countries. One of the hospitals that I was visiting last year in the fall, they were planning to go to the cloud. Do not do that. There's no infrastructure, there's no reliability. So it's great in developing countries. Great. You don't have the infrastructure. Cloud solutions are great for backup, right? But don't completely rely on a cloud infrastructure when you develop or install a PACS system in an LIMC country. We found out, of course, infrastructure, and we know that, you know, the power is always an issue. So we need lots of batteries. Of course, the emergency generator, and one of the things we kind of overlooked is the not only the availability of power, but also the quality of the power. So we actually burned out one of the computers. So make sure we have the UP, not only the UPS, but also the power conditioning equipment. And then, of course, the network infrastructure is critical. What we typically had to do, for example, Zinga, we pulled our own Ethernet cables for the ceilings and had our own little wireless, and actually, you know, it was actually wired switch there. So don't necessarily rely on the network infrastructure for the hospital for several reasons. It's not always as reliable, but it's usually very, very dirty. What I mean with that, people are connecting to it and they install what kind of software, they access the internet, so a big chance for security problems. Always, always, always use medical-grade monitors for diagnostic interpretation of x-rays. If you're interested, I actually wrote a separate piece about why we want to use medical-grade monitors, but the characteristic of a medical grade monitor is that every pixel, so every grayscale value of the image, is represented in a black and white value that can be distinguished by a radiologist. Every pixel, every difference between the different pixels can be distinguished by the radiologist because these monitors are calibrated. Commercial grade monitors are optimized for displaying text. So that means, you know, some regions like white or black areas, difference between individual pixels just cannot be distinguished. So you miss information. And the solution that we use, for example, in Zynga, a 2 megapixel medical grade monitor, is not that expensive. You can get them for $1,500, $2,000. But if you think about it, the $100,000 overall project is relatively little. So you don't want to save $1,000 on a monitor so that you end up with a poor quality display system. But another thing we learned, of course, we use local sourced new servers. One of our experiences, we actually shipped a server that was not used anymore by a hospital in the United States. A huge rack, complete with the RAID system and disks, several positions in the rack. Excuse me. So the system arrived there. Ran an old Windows operating system. We didn't know quite how to do it, and so instead we said, use the state-of-the-art, high-performance, small, single slot rack server that is locally sourced. So I would never recommend to use used computer technology, computer hardware, use the latest state-of-the-art for your IT computers. I think also computerized radiography is preferable, and the reason being, particularly if you do removable plates, the digital radiography plates, somewhat immature still, very expensive, $25,000 and up. Sometimes you pay $50,000. If you drop them, you're out of business. If you have several plates for computerized radiography and one fails, and you're still in business. So I always recommend computerized radiography unless you have a very, very high throughput fixed plate system, then we can use the digital radiography. We otherwise will use computerized radiography, flexible or rigid plate systems. Virtualization, think about it from an IT perspective. Virtual machines, very easy to deploy and to recover as well. And one of the things I thought is radiation protection is often an afterthought. We install the computerized radiography system and the digital system in Zynga, and then suddenly we said, what about protective gear for the technologists and for the patients? Some other lessons learned. X-ray units, the picture that I showed earlier, very simple units. X-ray units, proven, not as expensive. So this is called the Westside unit. And then cybersecurity threats. Of course, physical threats. I think one hospital, I think it was in Ghana, and they ended up installing cameras at each workstation. So physical threats, but also viruses is a constant. And one of the hospitals, I was in Egypt, I said to my class, so what are your most, what are your top one problem? And one of the participants said, we have a virus every week. So use patch management. Patching your operating system is critical. You need a PACS administrator when you have a PACS. Because if the PACS goes down, who do you call? Who takes care of the backups? What happens if you cannot find an image, right? You need to have a dedicated administrator that is focused on the PACS system. And then you need to train them. Now, the good news is that I'm active with the Red Aid organization. If you're not familiar with it, you should look it up. So Red Aid is a radiology aid, more than 10,000 volunteers. They send people like myself, instructors around the world to teach PACS administrators. In addition, of course, radiology aid, they teach CT, MRI, managing the hospital or department and so on, anything that has to do with imaging. And plan for scalability. You will see how quick you'll run out of archive space. And then if you need to get another 5 terabyte disk unit, we need to make sure that that you have that available way before you really need it, because you need to order it, you need to install it, and you have the system down and so on. And the same thing with database capacity. Scalability is really important. So if you have an open source PACS system that has a small database, free database, that's not as scalable, at some point in time you need to make sure you have a commercial version of a database like Oracle, Sybase, or some of the other ones, to make sure that we still can manage all the sufficient increased capacity. And backup, very, very important. Have a backup strategy. And it could be as simple as having a removable drive, making a backup once a week, and taking a removable drive to your home or to a place, you know, that is relatively same. So you don't, or of course, you know, more sophisticated, you can put a backup in the cloud as well. AI, artificial intelligence. Be aware of artificial intelligence. There's a lot of hype about it, but there's also a lot of some of the advantages that are starting to appear, particularly for LAMC countries. Acquisition support. What is acquisition support? The first point of care ultrasound acquisition support was FDA approved in the United States. And basically, when you have a non-trained, somebody's not trained, physician is not trained on ultrasound, they put a transducer on your belly or whatever the organ is, and the software will tell you a little bit to the left, a little bit to the right, push a little bit more, take this thing. So acquisition support, the first one was actually approved already by the FDA in the United States. And of course, for detection, right? A detection of TB or other diseases, and what we're thinking about right now, of course, the coronavirus detection. So some other open source components. So we have an open source PACS. One of the things that I showed was the interface engine. There's a MERV interface engine, open source, very popular in developing countries. What can you do with interface engine? You can map. So for example, your PACS system wants the patient information encoded a bit different, and then was created by the electronic medical record. You can map those fields. You can route the images to different, or the orders to different locations, and you can buffer it. If the system goes down, you can restart the queues. Very popular, MERV. And I use it myself as well, very powerful. For the electronic medical record, there's an open MRS for outpatient and for smaller clinics. One of the, when you install these systems, PACS systems in a teaching environment, it's critical, right, to have access to prior images and to create a teaching environment. And again, there's an open source, very good solution. We just deployed it in, was that in the Black Lion Hospital in Addis Ababa in Ethiopia. So RSNA Merck used a lot around the world. It's a teaching file system. You can label the images. You can have a different teaching file in a little server, and by labeling the images and archiving there, you can then retrieve them, and perfect for sharing and for teaching. There are some test and validation tools, right, that you can use called DVDK. For troubleshooting, we have tools, sniffers. All of these are completely free. And if you're really adventurous and you have a good IT staff and some smart guys, you can actually write some imaging software using open source toolkits as well. So I'm getting to my conclusion. Open source PACS systems are very viable, right? They're used quite a bit. Like I give the example of Tanzania runs on Clear Canvas. It provides a great start to start with a PACS system. And so you know what it is that you want and what you would need, right? And because the problem is, again, if you are not familiar with PACS, You get a dealer or you get a local representative, and they want to sell you a solution that is hundreds of thousands of dollars and it would definitely not be what you might need. Now, training is critical, particularly your tax administrator. It should be very knowledgeable and even more knowledgeable than a typical tax administrators in some of the developing world, because you have to do your own support, right? Particularly with open source tax system. And be really aware of good IT practices. You need to make sure you have a backup, you have a plan for scalability. And what happens if you get another donated MRI or the CT scanner is replaced with a 64 slice instead of a 16 slice? Your number of vendors goes through the roof. Be aware of cybersecurity, of course, and the infrastructure. So now it's time for questions. I put some links there. This is my contact information, my email, LinkedIn address, some of the resources. I'm looking to Red 8 for assistance with training. Rotary International, assistance with funding. I have heading up a team called DIMIST, Diagnostic Image Medical Imaging. And you can look at that up. So we provide support as a volunteer for people that want to go with the PACS route. A lot of information I have on my blog. And then if you are interested to know more, there's actually a book that I published, a PACS ebook, when you have the link. And again, check out Red 8. Great organization to support your needs for around the world for training, not only for PACS, medical informatics, but also anything imaging related. Okay, we're ready for questions. Cha, do we have any questions?
Yes, thank you, Sir Herman. We now have a number of questions here. So the first one is, please describe the role of RISWRT in this PACS architecture. How does RIS supplement the workflow to PACS and to radiologists and caretakers?
Okay, so the question is, what is the difference between a RIS, Radiology Information System, and a PACS system? Well, that's easy. A radiology information system is managing the department. The PACS system is managing the imaging, right, the images. So the radiology information system, the RIS, allows you to enter an order. It allows you to manage the reports. Right? So the orders, it also allows you to schedule the exams. Let's say somebody calls in and said, I want to have a CT scan next week. So instead of what I've seen, of course, all the time, when I go to a department and I go to the CT scanner, I have this big book, right? Appointment scheduling book, and all of the information is on paper. All of that can be replaced by a radiology information system. So managing orders, results, appointments, scheduling, all of the administrative work is managed by the RIS, the Radiology Information System. And it's the same with cardiology, Cardiology Information System, Laboratory Information System, LIS. All of these departments have their own system. Now, if you have an EMR, electronic medical record, then in many cases, the RIS is a component of the electronic medical record. We have a lot of deployment here in the United States from Cerner and Epic. So most hospitals don't use an independent RIS. They just use the EMR, whether it's Epic, Cerner, or whatever it is that they use, to do the ordering and managing the departments. So RIS, administrative, PACS, imaging. Okay, next question.
Our next question, most PACS are offered by vendors and they bundle the software licenses with their services. Is it a good idea to separate this into separate vendors, or better to have one vendor for software services?
Yeah, I think it really depends on the vendor. It really depends on the vendor. And not only it depends on the vendor, but actually I would even argue it depends on the local resources. Because what happens is maybe there's a PACS vendor that has great support. I mean, he has an engineer, and I've seen that example. As an engineer, I've seen some really good, smart people on the ground that support these systems. But then guess what? The person is either hired by a competitor or was being promoted. I've seen other cases where the local support is absolutely terrible. I went to a hospital myself in Ethiopia, and there was a problem. The images came up way too black, and I said, "Well, it looks like there's maybe an setting at the MRI." So the service engineer came in, and only thing that he could do is give me the password. I have to figure out everything myself, right? So I would argue that it really depends on the quality of the support people that are, you know, that are part of that organization. If not, then I would unbundle it, and then maybe you have to do a lot of yourself. Next question.
Our next question reads, most hospitals do not have vendor neutral archives. In a multi-vendor setup, what is a good strategy to introduce VNA?
Yeah, so here's the question about a VNA. And I actually, my first picture, I actually had a VNA in there, but then I took it out because I didn't think would be that needed. So if you think about a VNA, vendor neutral archive, right? That's an archive. It's almost like a super PACS. That would be PACS for the whole enterprise. So here's my VNA, and this is basically another database and archive, right? So if you have a VNA, vendor neutral archive, another super PACS that can then manage the whole hospital, not only radiology but cardiology and different departments, right? That would be another component. But remember, when you have a VNA, it adds complexity because we have two databases, two archives to manage. If you would start out, I would start with a simple PACS, right? And then eventually maybe you get a VNA and then you migrate the data to a VNA. So when you have a VNA, this is the enterprise archiving and database management system. The PACS system itself might only have, I don't know, 3 months of data, and then everything else goes to the VNA. I would start with a core PACS itself and then go to the VNA. Now, there's always exceptions. The hospital at KCMC in Tanzania, we actually started with the VNA. And so now after the VNA, of course, for whatever the reason was, but then now we said, now we're actually looking to get a PACS, right? So I would start with a PACS system first and then think about a VNA. Another reason is that you know what you want and you know what you need before you make this decision to get a VNA. And remember, we have two systems. You have to buy and a PACS and a VNA. So in many cases, you have limited funds. So start with the PACS first. Next question.
If a hospital adopts an open source PACS, where can they get support for services such as installation, configuration, and integration?
Yeah, that's the problem. That's the problem. There's no support. Either your local IT people are going to have to be trained, right? Or now, the good news is that PACS systems are, you know, there since when I got involved with PACS, really 1990s. So some of these PACS systems are very mature, very mature. So that means they don't break that down that often. There's a use group that goes with it. So if there's any question, you can ask questions. So don't get too anxious and say, well, I'm not going to use open source PACS because I'm going to rather have to pay $100,000 to get a commercial PACS or more. And so I have support. Again, when I look at Tanzania, the whole country runs on Clear Canvas. They don't, they figured out how to make it work. The same with DCM4CHC, another very robust, solid open source PACS system. So you have to make a decision. Sometimes it's, if you don't have if you have the choice to get another CT, work on a commercial PACS, maybe you're better off getting a CT. Train your local IT person very well, right? Get all of the books you can, take online classes, see where you can get Reddit in there to teach you, right? So, and if you really think about it, I found that even commercial vendors, the support is so poor that you have to learn it by yourself anyway. So why paying a lot for support if the support is poor anyway? You might as well use an open source packs and do the support yourself. Next question.
On the packs architecture side, I see DICOM, HL7, and CDA. Can you talk about the importance of standards compliance?
Yeah, well, actually, it's almost like a given. If you don't have a standard, you know, we cannot connect the modality to the packs. So now here's the good news again. So we have standards. here's my interface engine. Yeah. So even if you have a standard that have a standard HL7 output out of my EMR and a standard input, HL7 input into my workload provider, it's not quite always compatible. So the interface engines, where we can do some mapping and conversion, helps a lot. So we know we need standards and we know how to deal with different mapping between small variations of the standard. But I mean, if you don't have a standard, if you have a homegrown, and I see there's a lot, homegrown electronic health record system, and homegrown RIS, I mean, it works fine, but you cannot connect to the packs, you cannot send orders. So I see a lot of cases where the homegrown systems have needed to be having add-ons developed and that can exchange orders, results, reports, right, images in a standard way. Yeah, you have another question, Sarah?
Yes, our next question is, apart from the workflow differences involved, do we still need to have separate packs for radiology and cardiology? After all, if the inputs or images to be archived are all in DICOM, why do vendors sell them separately?
Yeah, so the problem is with cardiology. Sorry. Cardiology, if you really think about it, the only difference is really the viewing component, right? So the computing component, and for cardiology, you might have some specific features. You might have specific reporting requirements, but you're correct. The backend, the indexing, right, and the archiving, it's just images. From a DICOM perspective, it's just a file. Right. Now, what happened is that initially, the cardiology vendors were making their own PAC systems because of specific compression needs. So, cardiology, we do a lot of runs that have seen a loop acquisition that need compression. Otherwise, it will take forever to pull them up. We need to make sure we can replay them very quickly. So, the whole compression built into the PAC system, the cardiology PAC system, was very specific for cardiology. But by now, all of that is also built into radiology. Right? So for cardiology, the only difference as of now would be the viewing component. There's no reason why to have a separate radiology and cardiology PACs. And look for that. A lot of vendors did, particularly the top three and top five vendors, they bought cardiology PAC systems, they start integrating. But some of them still have a different database for cardiology and radiology. So your question is, why do we need have different radiology and cardiology PAC systems? It's silly. It is just traditionally grown like that, but there's no reason today that we would have needed a separate PAC for radiology and cardiology. Just to have a different viewer. Okay, have another question, Joe?
Yes, the next one is there an open source PACS you would recommend that's suitable for cardiology and pathology apart from radiology?
You should be able to do cardiology with DCM4CHC. You just made sure that you have the right, there's no reason why you couldn't use DCM4CHC for cardiology. Now, the only thing is pathology is a little bit tricky. If you do pathology right, then the DICOM encoding for pathology is quite different. Think about a slide. If you look at the slide for microscope, you need to zoom in, you have different layers. So that structure in DICOM to facilitate the digital pathology is different, and I'm not sure whether DCM for CHE will support that. But if you are basically take screen saves, pictures, like JPEGs of those images, and you encode that in DICOM, any of the PAC systems should be able to do pathology. Okay, next question.
All right, thank you, Doctor. The next question is, what is the viewer for DCM4CHEE? I don't see it in GitHub. Okay. Please share the name for DCM.
Okay, so most people use OVM. So that's a different one. And so you can go OVM and you can connect it with DCM4CHEE. It's a web-based interface.
All right, the next one is, I didn't notice DICOOGLE among the list of open source packs in your slides. What are your thoughts regarding DICOOGLE? Which?
I don't know about that, no. I know that the Google Health Cloud has a DCM for CHE infrastructure. So it's the Google Cloud services. But then again, I'm a little bit concerned about cloud, using cloud services because of the infrastructure requirements. But I know they have a DCM for CHE that you can actually, if you want to, you can actually try it out. Next question.
Our next question is it okay to use a private cloud with a secured network for PACS?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that question? You were fading out.
I'm sorry. Is it okay to use a private cloud with a secured network for PACS?
Of course, yeah, of course. If your infrastructure is correct, okay, there's no reason why not. You can go to Amazon or Google or Microsoft, and you create your private cloud. You just you install. Basically, when a cloud is nothing else than renting capacity in the cloud, and you can install your DCM for CHT there, for example. And if you want to do that, then you have much better control, of course, of the security, because you never know. I mean, there's always a reservation that people have. What if I share my information in the cloud? Is the cloud service provider, in some way or another, going to use that data? So private clouds are perfectly great solution, but why would you want to do that, right? There needs to be a compelling reason to use the cloud. If you have if you have a hospital, what is the reason to go to the cloud? Well, there could be a reason to have a cloud if you have multiple departments, if you're worried about backup, if it's cheaper, less expensive, but make sure your infrastructure is ready. Because if the network is down, the connection to the private cloud is down, you don't have access to the images, and that's what you want to avoid.
Right, thank you, sir. We have reached the time, but there are still a number of questions. Maybe we can answer one more question before we end. So the question what are the good methods to transfer bulk data, archive, and DB from an existing platform to a newer one?
So that's the challenge, and that's the data migration. So we have a PAC system. You need to migrate the data. And so first of all, to migrate the database itself, which is simple because there are not that many records. But if you have a lot of data on your archive, before you know, you might actually have a million studies. It could be a very lengthy process, right? And so what you would do, you really, to do it right, you put a new PAC system out there, right? But you need to have a migration controller. So the migration controller, so here's my new PACs. The migration controller queries the old database for certain data, and then transfer them to the new PACs. And it could be a lengthy process. It could take, if you have a really, really a lot of images, it could take actually weeks or months Well, I actually know about one hospital here in the United States that took them more than a year, but they had a lot. They had more than a million studies. Right? So what you need to do, you need to use a migration controller in between. And there are companies that actually sell these controllers. There's also services that do migration, but you can actually buy this migration controller and you can program it to automatically query the old images and then put on the new images. Now, if you have a commercial PACS that is new, most of the time the vendors will take responsibility of migrating the data. That's really part of the contract. When you buy a new PACS system, you said, I have so much data, what would it take to do the migration? And they know how to do that, or they outsource it themselves. Okay, is this was the last one, Sharon?
Yes, sir, Herman. Thank you for answering all our questions. To all our participants with unanswered questions, we will try to answer them offline if there is a chance. And we will connect you with Sir Herman.
So remember, my email is right here. I'm more than willing, just send me an email or connect me to LinkedIn. And
then before we end our session, I would like to call on Dr. Boon Chai.
Thank you very much, Herman, for your excellent talk and webinar. We got a lot of information and knowledge, and we hope that we can get your support from your knowledge to our network. Thank you very much.
Sure, you're welcome. Pleasure.
Thank you, everyone. Okay. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, goodbye.
Bye.